19 Frauen. We thank you, Lord, for blessing us thus far, sustaining us in every respect. Now as we go into your word, Lord, God, it's not just a routine thing, but we need you, and we pray the word will have free course. You know, you see the needs that are represented, Lord, and open eyes and understanding, Lord, convict, convince, save, deliver, Lord God, according to thine own will. Anoint your servant. Give us that divine aid, strength that we need in this moment, the divine authority from the throne of God, and we won't fail to praise your matchless name forever. Amen. 19th Psalm. Verse 7. If you'll read for me, please. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Former clause, verse 7, please. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. That's what we want to discuss with you this morning. Conversion, or converting the soul. Now we know that the word convert and conversion is commonly used in the religious realm. And I'm certain that most people minimizes the term conversion. And they do not place all of the emphasis that the word demands. Now I want you to notice David's expression here. He said the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. David is saying here that conversion is both instantaneous and progressive. Now, this is what has thrown most people off. This is why most people never becomes fruitful Christians. Why? Because all that they know of conversion is some little happening incident in their lives at some time. But David said the law of the Lord is perfect. You get it now? Converting the soul, giving you to know that it's more than just an incident, but the law or the word is constantly transforming the soul to a place of acceptance with God. All right, you pray with me. In Romans chapter 12, verse 1. Now, this message will be greatly doctrinal, so you need to listen closely, because this is a very vital doctrine. Romans 12, 1, if you will. I beseech you therefore, brethren. All right, he's talking to brethren. He's talking to people who are already saved, who have already had a work of grace in their souls. Are you with me? So I beg you, brethren. I beg you, justified people. I beg those of you who have gotten saved. I want you to listen to me. I want you to get the whole scope of the matter. Read.
I beseech you therefore, brethren.
By the mercies of God.
That ye present your bodies.
A living sacrifice.
Holy.
Acceptable unto God.
Which is your reasonable service.
And be not conformed to this world.
And be not conformed to this world.
But be ye transformed.
But be ye transformed.
By the renewing of your mind.
Amen. You're already converted. You get this. You've already had a work of grace. You've already repented. Amen. But that is just the beginning of the process. Are you with me? See, dear one, don't shout too high. Amen. Because you repented. Because there's much more for you. No, I don't mean that this idea of just going, getting a little better till you die. But that is much more in a definite way. There is much more that you've got to have in a positive fashion. All right, what does he say?
And be not conformed to this
world. Be not conformed to this world.
But be transformed by the renewing of your mind.
Your whole mind has to be reprogrammed before you're ready for service. Just saying, God, forgive me, and maybe he does, but you are a long way from ready. Come on. I know God has forgiven me for my sins. That's beautiful, but that's not enough. Come on. The Bible says, what, be not conformed to this world.
But be ye transformed.
But be ye transformed. How?
By the renewing of your mind.
Here is the problem. Many people are trying to strike out serving God with the same old mind. And you just can't do it. Why? You are thinking the same way as you've always thought. Amen. You want to please God. Amen. But that old thought pattern is the same. So Paul is saying that before you can be acceptable with God, before you can come to a place of real spiritual stability, your mind must be transformed, and that's not done when you say, God, forgive me. He is saying that it takes more. It takes more in a transformation than saying, God, forgive me, and even having your sin forgiven. Come on. He said, listen, when you say, God, forgive me, that means that God does just what you're asking for. He forgives you. Come on. But that is a transformation of your very mind and being after that. A lot of people are trying to serve God thinking the way they always thought. And in their unguarded moments, will you listen to me? Don't you realize you're going to be what you are? You can act different for a while, but eventually you're going to come back to right what you are. You can hear a good sermon and affect you, but you're going to end up what you are. If you got a mean spirit, you can try to act nice and hold your hand, but when you're pushed in the corner, you're coming out. You are going, and you, amen, you can try to, amen, be modest and amen, turn your head off, praise our God, but if you have the same old mind, you're going to end up lusting anyway, because that's the way you think. You've got to be transformed. How? You've got to have a brand new mind. That's why many people pray and get no results. They pray and mean business, but they come up with the same old mind. Their perspective is the same. They see things the same. You've got to see a thing different to act different. The reason why some people don't quit sinning, because they don't see the sinfulness of sin. Sin still looks respectable. Sin does not look bad enough to them, so they continue. Brother, let me tell you something. That's why people have to be under an enlightened ministry. Why? Because false churches today don't make sin look bad enough. The reason why people, praise our God, want to go around decorating themselves and painting it up, they don't see the essence of it. They don't see what's involved in it. They don't see what kind of spirit behind it. You've got to see it before you act different. That's why people ask so many questions. Why is that necessary? Why do I have to do this? That means they don't see it. That means they are thinking the way they've always thought. They want to be forgiven, but they're not transformed. And you are transformed when your mind is renewed. You've got to think different to be different. And it's going to take the pure word of God to transform you. That's why you got so many churches with a lot of worldly people who have not been transformed. They just decide they want to be better, or maybe sing in a choir. It's a little more effective and respectable to go to church. So they go, but no transformed mind. How do you know? Because they came in world and they're still worldly. They're still talking the same, dressing the same, acting the same. No transformation. And they get under false spirit. They work up an emotion, and that deceives them more. Brother, let me tell you something. There is no way in the world that you can live a holy life without a transformed mind. I can remember before God saved me, some of the things that the Word of God advocated was repulsive to me. I know people are crazy. I'll never do this, that, or the other. I'll never get a tithe of my earning. I'll never live celibate until this or that time. I'll never do this, that, or the other. Why? Because my mind was not oriented in a proper fashion. Come on. Because why would I go around denying myself of things that I could enjoy? Why would I refrain from doing it? Do it and say, God, forgive me. That's the way I used to think. That's the way most false religionists think today. That's the way they think. They figure, now I'm not going to suffer and cry and ask God for grace to not do it. I'm going to do it and ask God to forgive me. One of the greatest deceptions on earth. Why? Because their minds are the same. Their minds have been transformed and they are not exposed to that which will transform their minds. All right, read again, please.
And be not conformed to this world.
Don't be conformed to what?
This world.
Don't be like this world. Don't talk like this world. Don't dress like this world. Don't act like this world. And you're going to do it unless that mind has been changed. Unless your attitude has been changed toward a thing. Let me tell you something. All of these little things that's overthrowing us. You get this. You know, some people, I preached some months ago the sinfulness of sin. And I went into it. I dissected it. Because from the surface, don't you know some people do not actually feel there's anything wrong with fornication and adultery? I've heard them discuss it. Big people. They say, listen, even homosexuality. They said two consenting adults can do what they want to do. Nothing wrong with it. They know what they're doing. They're intelligent. And that's what they choose to do. Nothing wrong with it. That's what they say. I'm going to tell you, they want. And if you aren't careful, a lot of these little things that overthrows you, you're still doing it because you don't see the sinfulness of it. You're still doing it because you don't see how distressing and how black and ugly it is. That's the very reason why some people never will get deliverance. Why? You can't see enough wrong with it. It doesn't look bad enough to you. It still holds a degree of respectability to you. Come on. You need to get that mind cleared up, to get that mind transformed. How you know, they want? Because when that mind is transformed, you will hate the thing that you used to love. Yes, you will do. Why? Because your mind has perceived it differently. And the thing that you once hated, you'll love. Come on! Yes, you will do. And dear one, let me tell you something. When you hate a thing with a perfect hatred, you're not going to always be dibbling in it. Don't you tell me. How do you know? Because I know people in the world. If they hate somebody, they don't want to get near them. Come on! They don't want to be in the same room with them. Why? Because they just despise them. When you hate sin like you ought to, when you hate fornication and adultery and fleshy and worldliness as you ought to, you don't want to be close to it. Why? When you hate it with a perfect hatred, you will always be hanging around. You won't be going down to the bar drinking a Coke. Going out to the ball game to buy popcorn. Going to your girlfriend's house to listen to records. Come on, why? Because you hate the possible effects of it. Come on! You hate the very atmosphere of the world. Why? Because you recognize what it's doing to the people. And especially those proclaiming to be God's people. All right. Come on. That's why you don't want to get close to it. That's why you don't put yourself in a corner. That's why you don't put yourself in questionable position. Why you hate it. You show me somebody that's always flirting with sin. Always standing on the edge of the cliff. I'll show you somebody don't see the sinfulness of sin. I'll show you somebody that don't have a hatred for it. Why? You stay too close to it. Can I tell you something today? Will you be honest with your own soul? If there is something that you know according to God's word is wrong, you know according to the Holy Ghost is wrong, and you are always close to it, there's always an urge to be around it, there's something wrong with you. There's something wrong with you that's going to develop into your eternal ruin. Come on. Brother, if you find so much delight in worldly people. Come on. I mean, never nobody that you can pray with. Never nobody you can discuss the word with. The worldly people always offer you your delight. There's something wrong with you. There's something in common there that's going to destroy you. Hating the garments of those that are spotted by the flesh. All right. We said repentance is just the beginning. What did it say, sister?
And be not conformed to this world.
Be not conformed to this world.
But be ye transformed.
But be ye transformed.
By the renewing of your mind.
By the renewing of your mind.
That ye may prove what is that good.
You've got to prove something, and you can't prove it unless your mind has been changed. Brother, if you think right, you're going to act right. Come on. Over in Titus chapter 3. Beginning with verse 5.
Not by works of righteousness.
I said conversion involves more than saying, God forgive me, or joining church, or even coming to the altar. Real conversion. You get this. I'm afraid that separating the works of grace, as important as it is, has been a detriment to some people. Some people feel because we advocate and preach two definite works of grace that you can live on either level you choose to. Don't you know this? Unless somehow you die between in your process, you're not going to heaven unless you're sanctified. When I say sanctified, I don't mean go to a sanctified church. I mean having had two works of grace in your soul. You're not going to heaven. Why? Because some of y'all don't understand something here. Sanctification is the standard. Do you know Jesus preached sanctification? Jesus didn't preach no separateness in this thing. When Jesus, if you come to me, you got to deny everything. What else can you do? Jesus preached a sanctified standard. But we still make people think you can live on a justified, you have an option. You don't have no option. You don't decide what I'm going to live sanctified or justified. The blood will bear you over if somehow you die in the transformation. But if you have had an opportunity. Are you going? Yes, you are. Why? Because you are proving that you're trying to get over on God. You are proving you're trying to live on a lesser level and make it heaven. You know that more for you. And you know if you put all on the altar, you'll get it. But you think I can say I'm not sanctified and you get away. No, you're not. Well, you know I'm not sanctified yet. That's a detrimental spirit. Went to a meeting one time. A fella stood there and some of the saints were trying to be gentle with him. So let me tell him, you know I'm not sanctified. I said, you're not something else too. What I'm thinking. It's not just sanctified, you're not. He felt that I can get him, I can cut up now because I'm not sanctified and still be saved. Isn't that pitiful? Right. But you know, I'm living on a different level. Come on. Whether you testify, whether you have it or not, you're going to have to be sanctified to make heaven. God is not going to accept your cutting up no more. He's going to accept mine. God is not going to accept your carnality no more. He will accept it out of me. I'm going to get that today. If you can live on two levels, then God would have to apologize for me for getting sanctified. If one person can do it, everybody can do it. And it's a real work of grace. All right. Read.
Not by works of righteousness.
Not by works of righteousness.
Which we have done.
That we have done.
But according to his mercy, he saved us.
But according to his mercy, he saved us. Now get this. He did what?
But
according to his mercy, he did what?
To his mercy, he saved us.
He saved us. Now you get this. How?
By the washing.
Wait just a moment. Now you better get this. He saved us. You get this. The whole process of salvation, not a part of it. He saved us. How?
By the washing of regeneration.
This is how God saved us. You are separated. He saved us by the washing of regeneration. And what?
And renewing of the Holy Ghost.
That's how he got saved. And you're not complete without it. You are a partial individual without it. He saved us by the washing of regeneration. That's one element. But that's not all of it. Many people have had the washing of regeneration. What do you mean? The thing that you committed, you've had them washed away. Will you please pray for me? The thing that you did, you said, God, forgive me, he forgave you. But that did not convert that spirit. That did not, the new man, the old man, was not yet crucified. Are you with me? But there are many people trying to live a new life with the old man. And you better get it this morning. This is not just a doctrine, this is a necessity. And you can go on all your life on the altar if you want to, but you better try to get it before Jesus comes. By the what?
By the washing of regeneration.
By the washing of regeneration.
And renewing of the Holy Ghost.
The Holy Ghost does the renewing. When you are regenerated, it washes you from your actual transgression. But the Holy Ghost does the renewing. The Holy Ghost transforms that nature. I'll prove it to you. And your conversion is not complete until the whole work is done. That's why about three out of every person that claim to get saved never make it. Why? They never go on and crucify the old man. And as a result, they end up where they were. Why? They were washed by regeneration. The old committed acts were washed away, but they never got renewed. They never thought the same way. That's why it's so difficult for some people to act right. They're still thinking the same way. The same thing will still appeal to your mind. Dear, well, let me tell you something. You would be appalled to know the people who are all kind of old, dirty, sexy books still appeal to them, who would never admit it. They might try to refrain from it, but it still appeals to them. It still intrigues them. You'd be surprised those people could read old love stories and that kind of mess, and it still fascinates them. I'm telling you. Now, you see, if I would ask anybody that those things appeal to, raise your hand, you wouldn't do it. But you know from history, you know from what we have experienced, that I'm telling you the truth. Come on. And a lot more who have not fallen yet would have to admit the same thing if they would. You'd be surprised to know many people claim to be saved and on the job, when their co-workers bring them old books and how they can sit around from a distance and look at them. They won't bring them home. They won't buy them. They look at their buddy's books. Will somebody pray with me? They leave the Bible in a locker. Come on! And many more people than will admit it enjoys it. That shows you they got the same old mind. Come on. Some guys enjoy the bathing suit and the lingerie section. Will somebody pray with me? Of the catalogs. You know, a catalog is legitimate. The bathing suit and the lingerie section of the catalog. All right. Read.
Not by works of righteousness.
Not by works of righteousness. They do it because they got the same old mind. It still appeals to them. They want to try to get all they can get out of the world and from the flesh and still be saved. Come on! Read.
Not by works of righteousness
Not
which we have done.
Not by works of righteousness that we have done.
But according to his mercy he saved us.
According to his mercy he saved us.
By the washing
by
of regeneration.
By the washing of regeneration.
And renewing of the Holy
you
Ghost.
You better get that mind renewed. You better get that spirit. You better get that nature renewed. And you didn't do it just because you said, God, forgive me. You better know the extent of it. You need to know the extent of conversion. You need to know the completion of it. You need to know what all it involves and entails. And trying to hold Jack in the box is not the fullness of it. Listen to me. Let me say something to you that might sound paradoxical. Everybody not doing what they want to do. See, some people got caught up in the church of God. They committed themselves to it. Now they can't find a way out. They can't find a respectable way out, you know. Or they say, oh, I can just walk out if I want to. No, it's not quite that easy. Because, you know, too many people ask you why and all this. So you, rather than do that, you just try to hang around. But this truth is too much for them. But they can't find an honorable way out, so they just try to hang, just try to stick it out. They'd rather be sweethearting.
They'd rather be reading Playboy magazine instead of the Bible every once in a while. Come on! They'd rather be looking at peep shows instead of the Bible. And I'm afraid some might. What? I don't talk about it. All right, let's read a little further here. I'm going to prove something to you. Give me 2 Peter, please. 2 Peter chapter 1. Thank God. You better pray and pray hard because I'm not talking to the air. Come on with it. 2 Peter 3:1, if you please. 3:1. 1:3. 1:3. 1:3, brother. Beg your pardon. 1:3. Read.
According to his divine power.
According to his divine power.
Has given unto us all things.
That pertains unto life and godliness.
Through the knowledge of him that has called us.
Through the knowledge of him that has called us. Now this is what he calls us to. He doesn't call you to some little primary experience. He's calling all of us to glory and virtue. All saints should have a glorious life. All saints should be filled with the glory of God. There shouldn't be no little dried up, withered up saints. That's why some of you just sitting around. I tell you, brother. You need to know what God is calling us. You need to know what God is demanding.
Right.
Read.
Through the knowledge of him that has called us.
To glory and virtue.
Whereby are given unto us.
Exceeding great and precious promises.
That by these ye might be.
Listen. By these ye what? That these ye might be partakers. Not that you already. I'm letting you know that this thing called conversion is more than some little initial move you made. Amen. Most people never get fully converted. Most people that even get a touch from God never get fully converted. Brother, let me tell you something. Don't you know when God finishes you up, you don't just backslide like that. You don't just drop out like that. Every little wind don't tilt you in the wrong direction. Brother, conversion is a third work. Conversion is a revolutionary work. Conversion is a memorial. It's a memorable work. Amen. All right. Read a little further.
That by these ye might be partakers.
That by these ye may be partakers.
Of the divine nature. Oh,
now you get it. By these ye may be partakers of the divine nature. You get this? Every person that has identified themselves with the congregation have not been made partakers of the divine nature. A lot of people saying hallelujah don't know what the divine nature is all about. A lot of people been hanging around the church for years don't know a thing about the divine nature other than what they read or heard. Now we're going to talk to you about that just a little bit. Read on.
That by these ye might be partakers.
Might be made partakers.
Of the divine nature.
Will you please get this? Now get this, children. Let me see if I can't elucidate here. Might be what?
Partakers.
Uh-huh.
Of the divine nature.
Please listen. Please, will you please? May I have your undivided attention? Listen. May be made partaker of what?
Of the divine nature.
What is your nature? Your nature is what you do naturally. Your nature is a natural prompting. Then you don't have to think and strain to do. You do it ordinarily. Will you pray with me? It's the nature of a dog to bark. You don't have to train him. You don't have to teach him to bark. He just barks. That's his nature. Come on. It's the nature of a goat to butt. He does that. He's going to run into something.
Come on.
That's his nature. You get a little one and put him aside from other goats, he's going to butt. Why, that's his nature. You get this now. It's the nature of a sinner to sin. You were born like that. They come here babies doing contrary things and manifesting selfishness and all kind of attitudes and spirit. It's their nature. But now, Peter is saying here that you're going to have to be made partaker of a divine nature.
Amen.
Will somebody pray with me? You better get this.
Good.
You might not be ready for it, but you better get it. Read that again, please.
That by thee. Ye may be partakers.
Ye may be made partaker.
Of the divine nature.
All right, you got to have a nature that you naturally respond right. That you naturally looks off when the scene is not conducive to holiness. Not naturally do that, but naturally exist.
That's right.
I wish somebody would pray. I wish somebody would pray that you naturally respond sweet when provocative situations arise. I beg your pardon. I wasn't watchful. That's why I told you off. No. You see, you can't watch it, nature. See, your natural response. You see, will somebody pray with me? Please pray with me. It's a natural response. It's natural for you to act that way. Not only when you're watching, but that's your natural response. Amen. Be made partaker of a divine nature. You naturally act divine. You are divine. I'm not talking love talk now, you're divine. I mean, you're divine. That's your nature. You act like that because you do it naturally. That's you. See, some fuss boxes can speak sweet. Some people just fuss all the time, but under certain circumstances they can speak sweet. That's not them. That's not their nature to fuss all the time. So they're putting on when they act sweet. But you can get that nature transformed and you can be sweet all the time. Come on! Be made partake of the divine nature. Act divinely. Your promptings are divine. Come on. Can Brother Hampton instruct you a little this morning? Will you take my instruction? You are going to wear yourself out trying to be nice and live up to this gospel with old nature. You're going to wear you out. Because it's not natural. It's not natural for a person to live up to this gospel with old nature. See, we're always grinding you. Every time we're grinding, we're going to grind you to powder if you ain't careful. If you don't get that nature change, we'll grind you to powder. And that's why your seat will be vacant. Why? Because what we're preaching is not your nature. It's not natural for you to act like we're talking about. So you got to try to strain up and do it. So Peter said you got to be made partake of it. Peter said you can take it or leave it. Peter said you can go, you can put on for 10 years. But if you are going to be successful, you are going to be made partaker of the divine nature so that your nature will be divine. So you won't. So when your wife provokes you, you won't almost hit her. You almost kiss her. Come on. You better watch yourself. Come on. Your nature is divine. Come on. So that's why you don't talk back to mommy, because your nature, you got sanctified the other day, and your nature is divine. Read that for me, please. Will you please?
That by these ye might be.
Ye might be
partakers of the divine nature.
Of the divine nature.
Having escaped the corruption that is in the world.
Now listen, you've already escaped the corruption in the world.
Through lust. And beside this. Giving all diligence. Add to your faith
virtue. Now you're talking about full conversion now. Come on. Come on with it.
Add to your faith virtue.
Just read.
And to virtue knowledge.
Virtue knowledge.
And to knowledge temperance.
Knowledge temperance.
And to temperance patience.
Come on with it.
And to patience godliness.
All right.
And to godliness brotherly kindness.
Yes.
And to brotherly kindness charity.
Come on with it.
For if these things be in you.
Now you listen. If these things be in you.
And abound.
Now you get it. You've got to get them in you. They don't just come with a certain experience. You've got to get them in you. These things convert the soul. If these things be in you and abound, what?
They make you that ye shall never be barren.
They make you that ye shall never be barren.
Neither be barren.
Nor unfruitful.
In the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Why? Because you are thoroughly converted. Amen. Read on.
But he that lacketh these things
now,
is blind.
If you don't have these things, if these things are not resident, if that nature has not been made divine, you just have hung around church a long time and you cannot see off the end of your nose. You're blind. What?
And cannot see afar off.
Can't see afar off. That's why some people can't see it. You know that nature's not changed. That's why some people quit. You'd be surprised. Some people question this gospel. Some people actually repels this gospel. They don't see it, but they wouldn't say anything because they figure they'd be in the minority. But they can't see it far off. They just can't see it. Why? They don't have a divine nature. And it takes a divine nature to have a spiritual vision. Come on, read.
And cannot see afar off.
Cannot see afar off.
And have forgotten that he was purged from his old sins.
Have forgotten that he was ever purged from his old sin. Another verse.
Wherefore the rather.
Wherefore the rather.
Brethren.
Brethren.
Give diligence to make your calling.
To make your calling.
And election
sure.
Sure. For if ye do these things.
But listen. Give diligence to make sure that your conversion is complete. Make sure you didn't just make a good start and stop short of the mark. Make sure you just didn't get happy because you found out your sins were forgiven and just stopped there. And that's why so many people run out of gas after a few months. All of the inspiration some people ever manifest is done in the first 3 months. And after that, they just like a knot on the log. Why? They never got actually transformed. They were happy because their sin was forgiven, but they never actually got transformed. That's why people preach you can't live free from sin. What? They never get transformed. A lot of people do get saved. See, anybody that repents and turns to God, God save them. Wherever, whenever. But that's as far as they know. That's as far as they go. They are incapable of going further. Let's hasten on here. I want to get to something right quick, please. Turn to Luke chapter 3, quickly. Luke chapter 3, verse 15. Read.
And as the people were in expectation.
As the people were in expectation.
And all men mused in their hearts of John.
All people knew in the heart of John.
Whether he were the Christ or not.
Whether he were the Christ or not. Read.
John
answered, saying unto them all.
I indeed baptize you with water.
Now John said, I baptize you with water. Water is a cleansing agency. The gospel that I'm preaching tells you how to get your sins forgiven. By the washing of water by the word. That's what it represents. I indeed baptize you with water, but what?
But one mightier than I cometh.
But one mightier than I cometh.
The latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to unloose.
The latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to unloose.
He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost.
He is going to do, wait just a moment. Hold steady there for a moment. Turn to Acts chapter 18. Hold that in verse 24. Now you get to, because I want to leave this thing here before we close. And if you can't, praise our God, if you can't stay awake, go back here, Brother Bland, stand up. All right. Read.
24.
Yeah, Acts 18, 24.
And a certain Jew named Apollos.
A certain Jew named Apollos.
Born at Alexandria.
Born at Alexandria.
An eloquent man.
An eloquent man.
And mighty in the scriptures.
Now you listen. He was an eloquent man, mighty in the scriptures.
Came to Ephesus.
Came to Ephesus.
This man was instructed in the way of the Lord.
He was instructed in the way of the Lord.
And being fervent in the Spirit.
Being fervent in the Spirit.
He spake and taught diligently.
He spake and taught diligently.
The things of the Lord.
The things of the Lord.
Knowing only the baptism of
but
John.
But all that he knew was the baptism of John. And that was not enough. And all that many of you all know in actuality is the baptism of John. But that's not enough. Hear me today. That's not enough. John taught them how to get their sin forgiven. He was a man mighty in the scripture, convincing people, fervent in the spirit. But his conversion was not complete. And Paul couldn't just start shouting over his preaching. He said, wait a minute, son. I appreciate you doing a good job, but you are just half done. That'll fizz out on you. You're going to have to be made complete. And a lot of people today, they want... Because they can quote scripture and do a lot of things, you can't convince them that they need something else. He was an eloquent man, but all that he knew was the baptism of John. And in reality, that's all that many people knows. Read on.
And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue.
Listen, he was doing a mighty work. He spake boldly in the synagogue. Now when Aquila and Priscilla had heard, read... Took him unto them.
And expounded unto him the way of God. More perfect.
They said, wait a minute, son. I don't want to break up your revival.
But you're not complete yet. You jumped out a little too soon here. Come on. You got your little Bible and thought holding revival too soon. Either you'll be back, the devil will have you back in his clutches if you're uncareful. So let me tell you the whole of this thing. I want to show you all that's involved in this experience. Read on.
And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue.
Yes.
And when Aquila and Priscilla had heard, they took him unto them.
They took him unto them.
And expounded unto him the way of God more perfectly.
More perfectly.
And when he was disposed to pass into Asia.
Read.
The brethren wrote, exhorting the disciples to receive him.
All right.
Whom, when he was come.
When he was come.
Helped them much which
them
had
much
believed through grace.
Listen. Help them much who had believed through grace. There were those who were saved, and he was a great benefit to them. You get this, but it still wasn't complete. Dear one, you get this today. Now, this is not an option when I'm preaching you today. You need to see this thing today. Because that's why we have a turnover in our congregation, but ever so often. Why? Because they cannot see what I'm preaching this morning. They feel because, oh, I know God saved me. That's good, but you know, that don't mean you're complete yet. That don't mean you've been made partake of that divine nature yet. And you need to get that today. Read on.
For he mightily convinced the Jews.
He mightily convinced the Jews.
And that publicly.
And that publicly.
Showing by the scriptures that Jesus was Christ.
Showing by the scriptures that Jesus was Christ. But they couldn't let him go with that. Read on.
And it came to pass that while Apollos was
while
at Corinth.
Apollos was at Corinth.
Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus. And finding certain disciples.
Yes.
He said unto them.
All right.
Have you received the Holy Ghost since ye believed?
Say, now you believe and you're doing a mighty work, but have you received the Holy Ghost since then? You're convincing the people, you're preaching mighty, but don't get excited because you need something else. One of my slap you and you get mad and lose your ministry. Come on! Amen. Something might come against you and you react in the wrong fashion and you'll have to stop preaching. So let me stop you now so you can start back when you get fixed up. You better get it, children. And you know what? If I would take a census this morning, go all around over the town, over the country, if people would be honest, they would give me the same answer these people gave in reality. Read.
He said unto them,
all right.
Have ye received the Holy Ghost since ye believe?
Have ye received the Holy Ghost since you believe?
And they said unto him,
they said unto him,
we have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost.
What's that? What is the Holy Ghost? And in reality, most people would ask that question this morning. A lot of people talk about it, but they don't know what it's all about. A lot of people talk about the baptism of the Holy Ghost. They can't preach without it, but don't even know what it's all about. Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost. All that some people know about the Holy Ghost is some exotic physical demonstration. Or going off in some gibberish that's not a Bible. That's not Bible. Some people mistake a false tongue for the Holy Ghost, which is detrimental. Yes, they do too. They call that the Holy Ghost. And they're just as unenlightened as Apollos. Come on! They don't know what it's all about, brother. The Holy Ghost is far more than some gibberish or some that people don't understand. That has nothing to do with the Holy Ghost at all.
Amen.
Brother, what we're talking about, the Holy Ghost, the average person don't know what it's all about. The average person who supposedly spoke in tongues don't know what I'm talking about this morning. You hear me? We're talking about something far beyond that. And if they don't get lighter, they're going to be lost. All right, read.
And they said unto him.
Now, you probably better follow this. They said unto him.
We have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost.
Whether there be any Holy Ghost.
And he said unto them.
All right.
Unto what then were ye baptized?
Were we baptized?
And they said, unto John's baptism.
They said, unto John. Turn back to Luke now. Unto John's baptism. He said, well, John didn't tell you all the story. John admitted that he could only take you so far. John let you know that his baptism was limited. You better listen, children. Come on with it.
John answered, saying unto them all.
John answered, saying unto them all.
I indeed baptize you with water.
Here's John's baptism. I indeed baptize you with water.
But one mightier than I cometh.
Mightier than I cometh.
The latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to unloose.
I am not worthy to unloose.
He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost.
He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost.
And with fire.
And we're not talking about something to make you jerk. I'm going to show you what that fire is all about. I wish I had, but I can admit that it's been a long time this morning preaching the thing.
He will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And this is not something you give. I think God baptized the Holy Ghost with fire. No, it's more than that. Let me show you what this fire is talking about. John tells you. Read. Come on with me.
He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost.
Listen.
And with fire.
John's baptism only took you so far. John's baptism was a limited work. John's baptism was incomplete in itself. When John got through with you, you needed something else. When John got through, you needed the real thing. And I'm going to tell you about it. Read.
Whose fan is in his hand?
Thank God that one, what?
Whose fan is in his hand?
Back up a little bit. Shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, all right? Whose fan is in his hand? Read.
And he will thoroughly purge his floor.
Wait a minute. Here it is. He will thoroughly purge. There's a purging. Hallelujah to God. After God forgive you from your sins, there's a purging work. He shall purge who? His floor. Let you know you're already here, but you need a purging. Go to God. You're already here, but you need a purging. God has already forgiven you, but he got to purge that nature out of you. And he's going to do it thoroughly. He's not going to leave any meanness there. Not going to leave any pouting there. Not going to leave any second looking there. In a fashion. Not going to leave any getting even. Not going to leave any gossiping. Somebody pray with me. He going to thoroughly purge the floor. Go to God. Won't leave any husband disrespecting there. Won't be need no wife mutilating there. He going to thoroughly purge the floor. I'm in the Word of God. Come on. Brother, some people ought to be held to the horns of the altar and rotter it almost. And sitting back, like you got all the Holy Ghost in the world. No, you know what it's all about. You ought to be held to the horn of the altar, all of them. You ought to take your altar around with you. This thing is just as obscure to some people as it was to those disciples in Ephesus. You don't know what that be, Holy Ghost. And let all this gospel pass and still go and get it before God without it. Read on.
Whose fan is in his hand?
Fan is in his hand.
And he will thoroughly purge his floor.
Purge his floor.
And will gather the wheat into his garner.
Gather the wheat into the garner.
But the chaff he will burn with fire unquenchable.
That's what that fire is for. That's what that fire is for. It's going to burn up the chaff in your life. Oh, you listen to me this morning. Thank God. It's not a big deal. It's going to burn up that chaff in your life. That fire is going to burn up something. Praise our God. When you get baptism of fire, it's going to burn up something. See, there are two cleansing agencies you've heard me say. Water cleanses. You ever been to the hospital? They got a great big laundry there. And all that detergents and there, all that purifiers and bleaches and all that stuff. And they put it in a great big washing machine and wash those things. But there are some diseases that are communicable. If you had the AIDS, they're going to burn up that. They're going to purge it out with fire. Some diseases are so deep-rooted and so communicable that they purge it with fire. They burn it up. Well, something can be washed away and something got to be consumed away. You got a spirit in you. There's some things about you that the Holy Ghost got to burn up, got to consume it away. And unless you let God, amen, turn that fire loose in your soul, you'll die with it. That's why some people are going to end up, they never do get rid of that old nature. They're just as mean as they were 25 years ago. They're just as abusive as they started off. They're just as worldly, praise our God, as they've always been. They leave home and leave a good service like this and go home fussing. Come on! Come on! Whose fan is in his hand? Thank God the Bible says a thoroughly purged floor. But everybody that knows how to demonstrate religiously don't know what the Holy Ghost is all about. I'm telling you, that conversion got to be complete, children. Amen. The reason that most professed Christians cannot live an overcoming life is because their conversion is incomplete. And it's up to you and God, amen, if you have to make 1,000 trips to the altar. If you never give up, you never get it. And because you go to the prayer room 3 times does not mean you've got it. You can get it. You can get it immediately if you will. It's up to you.
It's dependent upon you. If you're trying to lose, let go and let God altogether, it's up to you. If you never do it, then you never get it. Amen. Your conversion is not just something you do or associate yourself with some good people or go to a certain church. Conversion is deeper than that, children. Brother, it's a complete work. And dear one, you don't want to go before God incomplete. You don't want to get tired of seeking and just let it go. Say, well, whatever happened, just happened. No, you can't have that attitude. Or think that if I just hang around, it'll work itself out. It won't work itself out. You're going to work it out. The altar's open. The prayer room's open. God has spoken. And now it's up to you. Shall we stand? Never get complete. You're going to keep going back. You're going to keep going back. You'll keep going back to the same old thing over and over and over and over again. Making decisions and remaking them. Dear one, there are some things and people need to get purged out of them. Dear one, there are a lot of people would fight today if they were provoked enough. I'm telling you. There are some people got those same old spirits there. And dear one, and you see them sticking their heads up every once in a while. We need to be thoroughly purged. Otherwise, we're going to end up, we're going to be like that one seed. It doeth for a while. It doeth for a while. Dear one, don't settle with a half purging. Don't settle with a partial purging. Settle for nothing less than a thorough purging. The Bible says he was thoroughly purged. You'll feel so good. It's so free, so clean to know that you don't have to be responding to the whims of the devil. You don't have to be kicked around by your passions. You don't have to respond to every little provocation. Let him do a thorough work. Well, brother, he's working on me now, but let him do it. Let him do a complete and let him do it thoroughly. Don't satisfy yourself because you look better than you used to be. That's not good enough. Maybe you are a little better than you used to be, but that's not enough. He will thoroughly. What shall we sing? You have longed for sweet peace. Have mercy, Lord. Have mercy. Prayed. You can't have rest. You'll never have rest. The devil won't let you rest. Perfectly blessed. All on altar is laid. Is your sacrifice laid. You can. You'll never be satisfied. You'll never have peace or sweet rest. You might not respond. You might not yield to the Holy Ghost. You might never seek after him, but you'll never be happy. You'll never be contented. You'll never have rest. You just won't do it. Now, dear one, don't let the devil make you tired. Say, brother, I tried. Listen, dear one, this is the only life you're going to have to try. And if you just go on and realize and get out of the grip with God and realize that you're going to be all or nothing at all, and you can save yourself a lot of trouble. God is not going to deceive people by making them think they're up there when they aren't. It's tiring. It'll wear us away if we go on trying to make ourselves be something. After a while, we'll wear ourselves out.
You're doing this for your own soul's sake, dear one. You're not doing this for the church. You're not doing this for the pastor. You're doing this for your own soul. You're going to need this as time goes on. You're going to need this when you are backed in a corner. You're going to need this when things get down low. You're going to need it. It's that nature we're after. It's not just preaching, trying to get you to do a lot of nice things. It's that nature we're after. We're trying to get down to the very core of your being. People can put on for anything. But I've seen people put on the best show, try to get wives and try to get husbands. I mean, they put on a beautiful show. Try to get a job and whatnot. They show good manners and all this kind of stuff. I've seen people do all kind of good things, but that's not them. That's not them at all. I mean, they put on all kind of demonstrations. I mean, they take anything. They don't get all the anything. You say, oh, yes, and you can fuss at them. They won't even respond. But wait until they come out. Wait until that little shell falls off. Then you're going to see something. You're going to see what you should have seen to begin with. It's yours. God have mercy. We need some altar workers here today, children. Now, if you have to miss your dinner today or your date or whatever you got to miss, I'd rather miss that, because if you don't get that nature right, you're going to miss heaven. And we need some qualified instructors here now, dear one, because we're not just going through a form. And if you're in the prayer room, in the altar room here, because we need to deal with these souls here today, because this is a vital thing. All right, if everybody's satisfied, you may be seated. But don't stop praying, children. Well, our altar work, brother.